All right, we were talking about JavaScript and forms last class, and one thing I wanted to remind you about is that, how do I want to put this? HTML5 has made some of the validation of HTML forms, has incorporated that into some new form controls. That's the good news. The bad news is that HTML5 is not completely supported across browsers, but I felt it would be worthwhile to mention it. As time goes on, and as you can count on people, and you can count on browsers to support HTML5 better, some of these things that we're talking about, you might not have to do. Now, you might have to write your own validation, for example, to make sure date 1 is less than date 2 or whatever. I don't remember all the HTML5 controls off the top of my head. But you might always have to write some of your own validation if there's like dependencies between two different fields or whatever. But I'd like to take a minute just to go over some of the HTML5 controls that are out there. And what if they're not supported? What happens? So, if we go down here to... HTML, oh, that's not what I want. Let's look up HTML input color object would be an example. This is new in HTML5, and we were working with colors last week. If you say type equals color, finally, HTML5 with an input type equals color allows you to get your browser's color picker. So you can, instead of having to type in the code like we were typing in the name of the color, you could click on this and you can get the color picker. You can pick whatever color you want. And then you can submit it. Alright? And it gives you the code. Unfortunately, this doesn't work on every browser. Let's see if it works on Edge. Notice it doesn't work on this version of the browser. So what do we get instead? We get a plain text box. So what does that mean for us? It means that we're back to square one. All right, we have a plain text box. If it doesn't recognize the input type, HTML, and the browsers treat it like it's a regular text box, which is kind of cool, which is kind of what we'd want to happen. So I guess what I'm saying is that these HTML5 input types are something to keep your eye on in the future, but at least for now, if you do use them, you're still going to have to write validation. All right. Another example would be HTML5 date. You get the date picker, and you can't pick an invalid date. You know, you can't put in some goofy date. Oops. Well, maybe a goofy year, but you can't put like the 13th month in there. I'm hitting 1-3 and it won't let me. But again, this is not supported in some browsers. So, oh, this one is supported in Edge. So the color isn't, the date is. All right, go figure. The bottom line is at least for now, I would not rely on the input types, the new HTML5 input types. If you do use them, you probably will have to write JavaScript as well. How do you know what is supported in each browser without going in and manually testing? There actually is a number of web pages that will show you what elements get supported. One of them is caniuse.com. So we can look up caniuse. Search for input. And this shows you, for example, which ones the color type is supported in. So it's not supported in Safari, in IE, in iOS Safari, or Opera Mini. So again, just something to keep in mind as you're doing this. All right, let's go and continue the example we had last time. In fact, let's go real quick and change it to be, oh, never mind, we're not going to do that. All right, here's the example we had last time, and I'm going to open up in Chrome, and again, we can change the foreground and the background color. So blue and white, and it will go and make the change. All right. We put validation in so that if we omitted something, must enter something in the foreground color, or must enter something in the background color. Alright. I think I also made it, if you put the same color in twice, tells you that the two values have to be different, because otherwise you wouldn't be able to read it. All right, let's look at the code quickly to review what we have. Again, this follows a basic recipe that we've had all along. First of all, some event starting the ball rolling. In this case, is a button click. It's not a submit button because we're not sending this to the server. All right, so it's just a plain button. A plain button, it can be used to invoke some JavaScript. All right. So in this case, we're calling the change color function. And the reason that we're doing that, we're calling a function, is because there's a whole bunch of things that we have to do. All right. That change color function consists of two parts. It consists, first of all, of calling the validation, and if it passes validation, doing these things, otherwise doing nothing. I could have put everything in the same function, but it just makes it nice and easy, all right, to have this modularized. If you think about this, if I was going in and I was interested in changing this, maybe there was a few other sections of the page I needed to change the color of. If I wasn't touching the validation, there's no reason for me to even look at that function. All right? How much easier is it then to just focus on these two lines of code without having to worry about looking at these? All right? And the reverse is true, too. If I only wanted to change the validation to add some functionality to it, all I have to do is look at the validate function. So, a few syntax things. Remember, case sensitive. Remember, the curly brackets or the braces are used to group things together. They group everything in a function together. They group everything in an if statement together, the true part, and if there's an optional else or false part. In this case, there are no arguments going to this function. That is, we're not calling it and passing it anything. We're simply saying, I want to make the color change. So there's no argument, so there's empty parentheses. All right. Here we have a series of if statements. If validate form, again, remember between the parentheses in a if statement, there needs to be a Boolean expression. What is a Boolean expression? A Boolean expression is an expression that can be evaluated to either true or false. So like in this if statement, I'm looking to see if the color in the background color equals an empty string or nothing. So that could be evaluated true or false. I'm looking to see, does it equal an empty string? If it does, the condition is true. If it does not, the condition is false. Now, why is there no equal sign in this expression, or no greater than sign or less than sign or anything like that? Well, because that function already returns a Boolean. It already answers true or false. So we don't need to do any evaluation. We set up a variable that we initialize to true. If we notice a problem, we change it to false, and we return that. So in either case, this function is going to return a true or a false. So we don't have to say, does it equal something? We can simply say the name of the function. And the return value will be a Boolean. It will be a true or false based on how we've written this. Okay, if the form is valid, we're going to go and make those changes, which are similar to the changes that we made back in the first week. The only difference being is we're grabbing a value from the form instead of having some hard-coded value. All right, over here in the validate form, this is going to be sort of a recipe for all your validations. All right. It is easier to assume the form is valid and then look for problems. The reason for that is if you assume the form is valid, to find out that it's invalid simply means one of the conditions is false. So if you're validating 100 things, if 99 of them are valid and one of them is not, then the form is invalid. So it's easier coding-wise to assume that it's valid and look for one thing that's wrong with it than to do the opposite, which is assume it's invalid and looking for a combination of the 100 things, and all of them have to be true. If you don't believe me, try and write it the other way, all right? And you'll find that it's much easier to do this. So our validations are all going to look like this. We're going to assume that the form is valid. We're going to, here we're clearing out the old error messages just so that we don't get any leftover stuff in there. And then we're going to have a series of conditions. And we're going to be looking for errors. What are the three errors I identified here? I identified an error for the one field being blank, for the other field being blank, or if the one field equals the other field. If I find any of those conditions, I flip that flag to false. So no longer is the form valid, it's false, it's invalid. And then I write an error message to a portion of the screen. Let's take a look at this statement because this will be important. And this will become important much later at the end of the class when we start talking about AJAX. Because with AJAX, you're getting content from the server and you're updating the content of the page, not just updating the appearance of the page. I'm pointing to an error field on the page, and I'm setting the inner HTML of it to a string, must enter something. And it's a spam, all right, which means literally, the inner HTML is literally the stuff between the starting and ending tag. So we're actually putting that string of text somewhere between the start and ending tag. What if I wanted that text to be emphasized? All right. There's a number of ways I could do it. I could set the style of that error to be emphasized. Or I could actually write this. I'll do it for the two fields must be different. I'm going to write strong, in fact. I'm going to strongly emphasize it. So now notice we get it bold. We got it strong. So you see what we're doing here? We're writing HTML. We're actually putting actual HTML in that location on the page. Actually, this location on the page. What if I wanted to put an image there instead? I would put an image tag in there. All right, that's relevant for your lab 3, where you have to put an image tag on the page. All right, questions about this? All right, let's go on to how we would do this if we were going to use a dropdown instead. All right, because we can see the problem with this is that, again, we don't want a text box in here. Because you can type anything in. And unless we're going to validate for everything, it's probably not a good idea. So it would be better to use a drop-down for this. The best, of course, would be to use the HTML5 control. But, again, we've seen that there's not complete browser support for that. So we're going to avoid that one. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make some changes. A drop down again is a select. It's going to have an ID of it's going to have a series of options. Now notice each option has two pieces. It has the value attribute, and it has the text between the start and end option tag. I'm just going to copy and paste this here and change the name and IDs. Now, how these two parts work together. The text that you have inside the option tag is what is going to be displayed for the user. So it ought to be what is meaningful for the user. The assumption here would be if you were making this page for ordinary users that they don't know HTML hex codes for colors. So if you showed them #FF0000, they're going to have no idea what that means. All right. So you give it in terms that they will understand. What is FF0000? It's bright red. What is AA0000 is medium red, and 33000 is dark red. So within the option tag is something that the user is going to understand. The value is what the script is going to see. All right? So up here, where I say, I actually don't even need to change much of my JavaScript at all, because the way that you access a text box is very similar to the way you access a dropdown. You use the value of it. So I can say get element by ID, txtbg. That's the same ID, right? I didn't change the ID. It's now a text box, and grab the value. And the value for it is going to be the selected value. So whichever thing I've selected, the value of it is going to be what the value of this element is. So let's go and make sure that this works. So now I have my drop down. I can pick dark red and bright red, change colors. Now, believe it or not, that looks like it's black, but it's actually a very, very dark red. I'll make it less dark in the next example. Going here. And we'll make it less dark. That might be easier to tell, but that is actually a very dark shade of red. Almost looks like it's black, but that really doesn't matter. We get the idea. Now, a problem with this approach is that as soon as we load the page, the default is set to dark. Well, let me open it up. As soon as we load the page, the defaults are set to bright red and bright red. That could be dangerous. Not really dangerous here, right? Because who cares if they change the color wrong? It's not that big of a deal. But you don't necessarily want to give your user a default unless it's really a meaningful default. All right. When is something a good default? Something's a good default when you're pretty sure most people on the visiting the page are going to use that value. A good example might be if you were doing a page for Lorain County Community College. You could probably assume, you could probably default the state to Ohio, right? Because most people visiting our website are probably in the state of Ohio. Now, to be sure, I actually had a student contact me from Michigan that wanted to take some classes online. All right, so, yeah, there's exceptions, but it's pretty safe. Go to your class, go to all your classes today and ask if there's anyone that doesn't live in Ohio. All right, and you probably will find it very rare that there is someone that doesn't live in Ohio. All right, so in that case, a default would make sense to default it. But if I was doing something on a more nationwide basis, it wouldn't make sense to default the state to Ohio, all right? It wouldn't make sense to default the state to whatever the alphabetically first state is, Alabama, I think, right? I would want to force the user to make a choice to pick, this is my state, instead of simply accepting the default. How would you do that? How could I make sure that I didn't just let the user accept the selected one? Because remember, dropdowns always have a value. It's always going to be the top value unless specified otherwise. Yes? Yeah, add another one for please select, and then watch what we're going to do here. We're going to give a value of an empty string. So, because this is the top one, by default, this will be the one that's selected. And if the user doesn't change it, well, again, the exact same code that worked before is going to work now, which is kind of cool, all right? Kind of cool. Please select. So if I click change color, I still get my error messages. Less than or something, and two values must be different. Actually, the reason, why do I get that error message instead of the one missing? Well, because the way my code is written, I'm using the same location on the screen to write two different error messages. I probably should do this. Give a different place to put the same color selected message. So I really see all three error messages. It's probably a better way to do it. So what did we learn about using dropdowns? We learned that there's good news, all right? We learned that the code to do dropdowns is virtually the same as the code to do a text box. We can use the ID to point to the dropdown. And remember, the ID is going to point to the ID of the select HTML element. And we can ask for the value of that element, just like we did with the text box. So, other than changing where that second error message got put, I didn't change anything in my JavaScript, and it worked for text boxes, and it worked when I changed it to a dropdown. So if you learn one, the difference between this, the display value, and this, the value that the script sees. All right, so you're always going to have that. One is going to be descriptive so that people understand it. The other is going to be what the script needs to get its job done. Questions about that? Oh, if everything in life was this easy. All right? And we're going to complicate things by talking about radio buttons. All right? Because radio buttons are different. Checkboxes, by the way, are similar to radio buttons, just as an FYI. All right? What are radio buttons? Radio buttons are like drop-downs in that you have a set of options, and the user can pick one of them. And by default, a drop-down, you could only pick one, and likewise with the radio button, you can only pick one option. All right? So let's change this to use a radio button, and we'll find that to access a radio button, it's going to be a little bit different. I'm keeping the same name and ID, by the way, simply because just for consistency between the examples. I'm going to do something that I almost never do. I'm going to put a break tag in there. Don't tell my 216 class. You can probably guess already that things are going to be a lot different, because notice that in the past when we've done this, I mean in the other two examples, we only had one ID to worry about. Here, each radio button element has its own ID. Here, the ID and the name are different. And the reason for that is the nature of the radio button. How do radio buttons work? Again, they work as a group. So if I click one option, it automatically turns off the other options. So I can only have one thing selected at any given point in time. All right. What ties things together as a radio button is the name. So the fact that these all have the same name, TextBG, indicates that they're all a radio button. All right? Indicates that these are all one radio button group, I should say. Type equals radio is what indicates they're a radio button. All right? But the fact that they all have the same name means that they act like a radio button group. All right? I still need to refer to each individual option, though, because I need to determine which one got picked. Therefore, what I have to do is I have to look at individual IDs for each of the radio buttons. All right. There is no one ID for the entire radio button group. It'd be nice if there was, right? With the drop-down, there is one ID for the entire drop-down. But there is no single ID for a given radio button group. Therefore, I have to look at all three of these IDs to see which one of them is checked. All right. So my code's going to be a little bit different. I can't simply ask for what's the value of this radio button group, because there's no single ID associated with the radio button group. I have to look at the individual radio button elements and decide which one of them is checked. And then that's the one I'm going to use. All right? Now, I'm a firm believer in doing things just a little bit at a time. All right? So, we're going to have to change the validation. We're going to have to change foreground color, but for now, I'm not going to worry about the validation. All right. I am instead going to write what we used to call in the old days a stub function. What's a stub function? A stub function is where you have a function that doesn't really do its full job yet. So, for example, this validate function is going to need to validate radio buttons. We don't know how to do that right now. So what are we going to do? We're going to fake it. I'm going to just delete all this code, and I'm going to have it return a true. All right? Until I know how to validate it, I'm just going to say, yeah, it's valid. And then later on, of course, I'm going to need to go back and fill that in. All right? But at least I can keep the rest of my code the same. All right, because I'll still call this function. In this case, it's always going to return true. All right, but that's okay for now. Now, the line I have to change is this one right here. The text foreground still is going to work because I haven't changed that yet from a text box, I guess, or a drop down, whichever one, a drop down. So here's what I have to do. I have to set a variable for my BG color. I'm going to initialize it to an empty string. What I have to do is I can't ask for the value of the radio button group because there's no ID associated with the radio button group. So I'm going to have to use the IDs of each individual one and see if it's checked. So, if document get element by ID, txt bg bright checked equals true. This is going to test to see if the first radio button of that group is checked. Is this specific radio button checked? If it is, then my background color equals the value associated with that checked. With that radio button. So I'm going to copy this three times. Then I'm going to say alright, let's make sure this works and we'll go back and we'll study it. Alright, got my radio buttons. I click on bright red. Or let's click on medium red. Then I click on dark red. I click change color. And it made the change that I wanted. Click dark red and bright red. There. Alright. We're not going to worry about the drop down because we already sort of know how that works. We're going to look at the radio button now. What happens when I click change color? Well, when I click change color, it's going to call the method change color. Change color is going to call the validate form method, and then it's going to do this stuff. Well, validate form we're faking for now. We're just saying yeah, it's valid. All right, we're not even bothered testing anything. So this is true. So we're in here. I'm creating a variable for my background color. I am looking, I initialize it to nothing. I am then going to look in turn. If each of these radio buttons is selected. So I look at the first radio button. Is the thing to have an ID of BG or TXT BG Bright, is it checked? That's either a true or false. Either it's checked or it's not checked. If it is checked, then the color that I want is a color that is contained in the value of TXT Bright. So I look to see if this guy is checked. The thing that has an ID of TXT Bright. If it is checked, then I'm going to store the value of it in my BG color variable. And then I do that in turn. I then look to see if the next one is checked. And if it is, then I use this as the BG color. Finally, I look at the last one. Now, logically, you might say only one of these if statements is going to be true. And you're absolutely right. But you know what? It's more straightforward to just test them first one, second one, third one. There's no need to really worry about, well, I'm calling three if statements when really only one of them are going to be true. So what? the processing time to test all three of them is minuscule compared to how confusing you'll make your program if you try to write a bunch of else's. Alright? So, when I'm done, bgColor has the value of whichever one is clicked on. And then I use that variable, bgValue, to change the background color. Now, how would I do the validation? I'd do it a similar way. All right? We don't have time for that today. We'll pick that up on Wednesday. Now, the other thing that you should be aware of is, as a programmer, anytime you see code that looks duplicated or close to duplicated, you should ask yourself, is there a better way to write it? All right? How many of you remember Pee-wee's Playhouse? Okay, I would be real disappointed if no one in the class remembered that. All right? Pee-wee's Playhouse, they always had the word of the day. And anytime the word of the day was said, you were supposed to scream. Which, if you think about it, what a great thing to put in a kid's show, to have the kids scream periodically just to shake up the parents, right? All right. Duplicated code is like Pee-wee's word of the day. When you see it, you should scream. Not literally, all right, but scream quietly to yourself, because that's a sign that you could probably write the code better, all right, if you just think about it a little bit more. And that'll be the second thing that we do next time. Besides writing the validation, we'll look and we'll say, these three statements are almost identical. Is there a way that I can look at them and write the code so that only one thing only one set of code exists instead of the same code three times? All right? And that will simply make it easier to maintain. All right? Because if you think about it, right now I have three options for color. If we added three more options of color, then we'd have a whole bunch of instructions here. All right? Whereas if I could write some streamlined code, if I could add as many colors as I want to, and I don't have to change the code at all. So that's what we'll be looking at next time. All right. Questions? All right. I will go unlock the lab. I'll come back here to get my stuff, and then I will be back in lab.